legal constitution for those of you who may be faint of heart. This is a tale of revenge and retribution. So if you're smart, before we start, you'd best depart.
You'd best depart. A nun from Leicester lost her wits.
You might avoid the first or second row.
Blood may spill, and spines may chew. It's ghastly still. We thought you ought to know you'd be a fool to wait. It's not too late.
For God's sake.
For God's sake.
For God's sake.
Bentonville Prison, 19th of October, 1909. This is the memoir, perhaps final confession of Lord Navarre, 9th Earl of Highgate. It is a fact of life that no one ever really tells the truth about himself, but in the event of my execution, while I still have time, I decided to leave behind a purely factual record of events. I suppose one could call it a gentleman's guide to murder. Or should I say, love and murder? My story begins, as stories often do, with a quite unexpected visitor.
Hello! Oh, there's a Sawyer Street in all of Clapham. I'm sure I've never seen it.
Excuse me, ma'am. Do we know one another?
Only since the moment you were birthed by your sweet mother.
You knew my mother. I've only just returned from her funeral.
Oh, my poor dear Isabel. That is so. Oh, look at himself, all grown up and handsome as a devil.
How is it you knew mother, Mrs.?
Miss. Shingle.
Oh, Miss Shingle. Mother spoke of you often. She looks forward to your letters.
And I heard, I assure you. You were going to offer me a spot of tea, were you?
You must forgive my manners, Miss Shingle. Mother always had a kettle on.
And if you could spare a biscuit or two, I'm sure I wouldn't mind. I knew you and your mum were having a rough time of it, but I didn't think it'd come to this. Have you any prospects of...
Mother always dreamt I should go to Oxford or Cambridge. Seems rather unlikely now.
There's nothing your mother wouldn't have done for you.
I shall hardly know how I'll go on without her.
You rather favour your father. Physically, I mean.
Did you know him? He died when I was but 7.
Only met him once, love. Castilian, you know. As dashing a face and figure as you will ever see. Tell me, love. What do you know of your mother's side of the family?
Mother never spoke of them. Must have been curs and mockbacks. Horse thieves at the very least.
Well, not exactly. Have you heard of the Dicewith family?
Dicewiths? Well, yes, of course, hasn't everyone?
Then you've heard of Highhurst Castle?
Of course.
You're aware, then, of their position, their vast wealth and influence?
Yes, yes. What's it got to do with me?
You're a Dicewith.
What?
You're a Dicewith.
No.
Oh, the Dicewith blood is flowing through you.
Me, a Dicewith?
A genuine bona fide Dicewith.
Rubbish.
Of course you don't believe me, do you?
You must be mad.
I'm as sane as the day is long. And, according to my estimation, only 8 other relations stand between you and the current Earl of Highhurst, Lord Adalbert Dicewith himself.
My mother took in the laundry of the neighbours and scrubbed the floors until her hands bled. Does that sound like the life of an heiress to you?
Very well then. If your mother was not a Dicewith, what was her maiden name?
She always insisted that the only name that mattered was my father's.
Your mother lived like a princess in every way, the daughter of Lord Maximilian. Till she met your father one fateful day, she knew it was love, and yet the family declared to be led astray. only by a climbing, conniving Castilian. Let him give, or else you'll know a life you will live to regret. This was no idle fret, nor a dice with your a perfectly breedable dice with. And a dice with does her duty, don't forget. There was nothing your mother could say. She eloped with your father the very next day.
So she was disinherited?
In a word, yes, despicable, the lot.
Poor mother. This explains her bouts of sadness and her obsession that I should rise above my class.
Oh, my. I haven't seen this old jewel box in years.
I found it hidden among mother's things. Can't make out how it opens.
Like this.
Letters. Dozens of them. Written in mother's hands too. Members of the Dicegood family. All returned, unopened.
Anything else?
Yes, a document. My birth certificate. Montague Dicegood Navarro. So it's true then. Oh, how mother must have suffered.
Your mother made me promise I'd never tell. But now she is no longer living. She wanted to spare you a private hell. But I think you deserve to know. Take this knowledge and use it well. The family may yet be forgiving. This will guarantee you've a right to be on the family tree, and it seems to me indisputably heir to time. You're a dice with the D apostrophe wise with, there can be no other way to view it. Montague, you're a dice with.
I'm all of a sudden a dice with.
Yes, then it's time that everybody knew it. You are the son of the daughter, of the grandson, of the nephew, of the second Earl of Highburton.
I am the son of the daughter, of the grandson, the nephew, of the second Earl of Highburton.
The thought occurred, why should I believe a woman who might very well be insane? And yet, there seemed to be an air of authenticity to this document.
I'm a dice with.
You're a dice
with. It would seem I'm a dice with.
You're a dice with. Montague, I picture you at Highhurst.
Yesterday I was Monty Navarro.
You could be an owl tomorrow.
And Highhurst could be my host. I'm a dice with.
You're a dice.
Lord Asquith Dicegood, Chief Officer, Dicegood Banking House, Bond Street, London. Allow me to introduce myself. I'm the son of your late cousin, Isabel Dicegood Navarro. It happens I am in need of employment, and I am writing to ask if you could possibly find room for me in the office of your stockbroking firm. I am considered honest and reliable, not without intelligence or common sense, and I am not daunted at the prospect of hard work. I look forward to your reply most eagerly. Sincerely yours, Montague Dicegood Navarro.
Don't you just love me in pink? Oh, would you please?
Yes, I.
Maybe a flower on my hand. No, no. Yes, no. Violet, no, a tide of roses. I think. Oh, won't you write me charges? No, no, I don't dare. Now, do you hate these earrings?
What's the matter?
Now, the truth. Don't be kind. Lie in mind. Because I hate them too. Oh, no,
lied to.
I don't know what I'd do without you. And I have never met another man who's half as dear as you. You're so clever too, and you make me love more than anybody. Why have I been so dearly Monty, and you're so deadly dull? No one holds a conversation half as beautifully as you.
Well, actually, Sibylla, there's a matter of some urgency. I should.
You haven't said a word about my dress. You're a brute. Look, see how it moves when I try to do what to. It's a bit much for glamour, but nevertheless, maybe just a bite, just to be polite. Monty, that's too tight. Monty, that's just right. And oh, time it you through. And I don't know what I do. I do not have a clue. I don't know what I do without you.
Sibylla, I have wonderful news.
Oh?
Yes, it seems I've learned I'm in line of succession to be Earl of Highhurst.
Earl of Highhurst?
Yes, it seems my brother was a dicesmith, which means I am a dicesmith too.
And pigs might fly, as if you could have been a dicesmith all your life and not have known it.
Well, I realize how it sounds.
And as if you could ever be an Earl. Eight people would have to die for that to happen, and how likely is that? Now don't go yet, your lordship.
Where are you off to in your pink dress?
To meet a friend with the motor car.
Does this friend have a name?
Lionel Holland. You're jealous of him, I can tell, because he has a motor car, and he's rich, and good looking. Is it really true about you being a dice queen?
Of course it is. I can show you the papers
no,
if you...
if you say it's true, of course I believe you. Darling, we barely spoke at the funeral. I'm quite all right. I should be inconsolable if I'd lost my mother.
Sibylla, I think it's time you took me seriously.
Monty, the man I married will have a wealthy position.
I will have wealth and position.
And what will we live on until then?
Sibylla, has it never occurred to you to marry for love?
Now you're being cruel.
Miss Halswood, Mr. Lionel Holland is here for you.
And right on time. If only he weren't so predictable. Oh, Monty, where's my glove? You really are in love. Monty, don't look so blue. I don't know what I do. I do not have a clue. I don't know what I do. You. Oh, don't you just love me in pink?
To Mr. Montague Navarro, 61 and a half, Clapham Drive. Mr. Navarro, regarding your workship with my father, after
careful consultation with several members of the Dysquith family, it is my duty to inform you that we are unaware of the existence of your mother, or consequently, yourself. It would therefore be of no use to trouble the firm or the family again. And further, if you should ever attempt to call yourself by the name Dysquith, we shall be forced to turn the matter over to our solicitors. Definitively,
Asquith Dysquith Jr.
Welcome to Visitor's Day at Highhurst Castle, ancestral home of Lord Adalbert Dysquith, 8th Earl of Highhurst. It is from these very walls that the Dysquiths past defended themselves against the great King John.
Ah!
Who was to meet his rebellious barons at Runnymede? In the banqueting hall, you'll find a coat of mail worn by Richard the Lionheart.
Ooh.
Come along, come along. That will be the effect, please.
Monty Navarro, you know you don't belong here. Monty Navarro, you're on a slippery slope. Your presence is indifferent to
may we suggest we think it best abandon hope.
Abandon hope.
But go ahead and take the tour as long as you are here. Buy yourself a souvenir or two.
And one thing more before you're out the door.
Sibella will never marry you.
Hey, I say you did. Hands off that sword. Put down that book. Is it enough we let you look? I hate to dash your futile little hopes, but you pay your sixpence and stay behind the ropes. I cringe when every cobbler or butcher or farmer comes touching my banisters, banging my armor. They finger every finial, they poke your cornerstone. Who'd want to be reminded of what they'll never own? Though my politics are purely democratical, I find the species frankly problematical. I don't understand the poor. No, I don't understand the poor. The lives they lead or want and need, I should think it would be a bore. It seems to be nothing but stubbornness. What's all the suffering for? To be so debased is in terrible taste. I don't understand the poor.
To be so debased is in terrible taste. I don't understand the poor.
I think he's poor.
He does not understand the poor.
I don't understand the poor. And they're constantly turning up more. Every fisting slum and twisted dumb is escorting a jump by the score. As a pimp to someone's ambition, say the people get better or more. From what I can tell, they do quite well. They're rising above and it's what they love, but I don't understand the poor.
They're rising above and it's what they love, but I don't understand the poor.
Where's the dignity?
Where's the dignity?
Where's the pride?
Where's the pride?
The inhumanity.
What?
Or putting the lame and the hopeless on. Why futurity? I'm perplexed by their attitude. I contend we extend them too much latitude. My tenants have no excuse. At Christmas I give them a goose. The integrity, where's the gratitude? I don't understand the poor. How I long for the days of yore, when many a vessel dipped into your castle, they knew not to dock in your door. Now they barge in every Tuesday with a sickening, thickening roar. Why clatter and trample, sin and temple, we teach them to read. But do they succeed when they're hungry and frail? We beat them in jail. We send them to war. I don't understand, I'm not being grand. I don't understand the poor.
I don't understand, I'm not being grand.
I don't understand, though I admit there's one I adore. He's missing a leg, but a very good head. A gentleman through to the core. He may be a bit of a drinker. He can often be found on the floor. Through all of his pains, he never complains. He's bright as a stoop. A shame he is mute. According to Mother, he may be my brother. A fact we all choose to ignore. But I don't understand. I'm sensitive and I don't understand the poor.
I don't understand. I'm sensitive and I don't understand.
I don't understand the poor.
Don't understand.
Really, I don't.
When I was in Golden Point to visit the hospitals, I was compelled to make one attempt to connect with my mother's family. The Reverend Lord Ezekiel Dysquith was one parson in the family, and I envisioned that he, more than anyone, might receive me with sympathy.
Childhood summers together at Highhurst, you know. Glorious day
glorious days.
I'm afraid there's quite a bit of family history I haven't been privy to.
The chancel was added in 1621 by the first Earl himself. It contained three late 12th century windows depicting the martyrdom of Saint Ursula and her 11,000 virgins.
Ah, yes.
Notice how the attenuated shafts sweep unbroken from floor to ceiling. A perpendicular period, of course.
Of course.
I must show you the tower.
So, can I count on you then, Lord Reverend, to put a good word for me with the Dysquith family? Perhaps with the Earl himself?
Oh, I really couldn't. No, no. I make it my business to stay out of family intrigue. Much better that way for everyone concerned.
Oh.
Ah, the Carolingian arches of my groin vault are pointed instead of round, recalling Palladio's Palazzo della Ragione in Vicenza. The belfry is early Romanesque, which retains a bit of the Byzantine influence.
What a marvelous view, Your Lordship. Are you sure you couldn't make an exception in this one case for my charming mother, or perhaps for my grandfather, your childhood playmate?
Oh, well, that's it, isn't it? If Isabel's own father suffered to disinherit her, then who am I to deny his wishes? You must move closer to the edge to truly appreciate the architectural significance of the flying buttresses. They're said to be influenced by the cathedral at Chartres.
Have you no Christian charity, then?
Pardon?
That was her only sin, after all. Only love.
Yes. Now, lean backwards as I do. There. Have you ever seen such horizontal thrust? Isn't it splendid? Oh, I'm afraid I shall need your hand, please.
Yes, of course, my lord.
Foolish to think I could let him fall. He's on the brink, it seems. But why should I pause when I know the cause of mother's shattered dreams?
Help me, you presumptuous climber!
What can I give to the Dysquiths to repay their warm embrace? What can I take from the Dysquiths except perhaps their place? But with eight other Dysquiths ahead of me, their foolish pride survives.
I beg you!
What can I take from the Dysquiths except perhaps?
Oh, please!
Perhaps their lives. Will the foolish
rather typical for that time of year. And it was no secret among his flock that Lord Reverend was prone to inebriation. Had he deserved it? I couldn't say he hadn't. What I did know for certain was that in one moment, my life was now changed forever. I now had a series of increasingly humiliating jobs. I shuddered at the prospect of endless days of hopeless drudgery that other men might grow rich. Men like Asquith Dysquith Jr., the man who had snubbed me so unmercifully when I wrote his father. I discovered the young bounder was being assisted to sow his wild oats by a certain Evangeline Barley, who had recently completed a run as Floradora girl at a music hall in Hackney. I discreetly observe their comings and goings.
I'll see you Saturday then, Asquith.
Our train leaves Waterloo at 7:30. It should be empty then.
I followed them up to a winter resort at Chisley.
Extraordinarily private and quite out of range. The hotel register has an unrivaled list of false names. I trust you don't mind our being discreet.
I've never known a man to take such care of my reputation.
Madam, do I know you from somewhere?
Certainly not. What are you insinuating, you insignificant upstart?
I meant no offense, I assure you, I...
Were you raised in a shanty town by some chi-chi punkawala?
Oh, Asquith, look! There's people skating on the lake! Doesn't it look fun?
What a shame we didn't bring our skates.
We can rent them right on the dock!
It's getting a bit late, don't you think? Nearly time for Betty Bye.
Oh, Assie! Please, 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 let's...
Oh, all right, Crumpet. I say, may I warm my hands in your muff?
Assie! Oh, my God.
You and I go sailing by, and no one will know where to find us. Unseen, unknown, and blissfully alone, we're leaving the riffraff behind us. All afternoon in our sweet cocoon, our cares for the moment at bay. Side by side, who knows how far we'll glide, bid the wet goodbye, eagerly we fly away.
I'm standing here with poison in my pocket, standing on this frozen little dock. It seems that now at last I let them escape my opportunity away. If I had the poise to put the poison in a pot of tea or else a shot of gin, I would be back amid the noise of London by the end of day. But no, I'm standing here with poison in my pocket, one eye on the target, one eye on the clock. It better happen soon before I lose my nerve and run. If I had a knife, I could have grabbed them, then discreetly knocked them on the head and stabbed them, not to mention what I would have done if I'd had a gun. Then again, the thought occurs, if I had truly taken stock, it might have stopped me putting poison in my pocket. What a fool to travel all this way and not think twice. Murder's not a hobby for the cautious. Thoughts of violence can make the timid nauseous. Unless, of course, the victim plunges head on through the ice. It appears that I've been handed quite an opportune solution. All that still remains is proper execution. I'd better join them on the lake before it gets too late. Suddenly there is no stumbling block, which means that I will need the poison in my pocket. What a stroke of luck, Sabella teased me till I had learned to skate.
Closer now, time is racing.
Now
time is racing on. It's all a matter of pacing. In a moment, this moment will be gone.
With the rhythm of the violinist, I'm wearing thing to ice things to create a hole in which the tragic lovers meet their demise. One would call this rather diabolic. It's strange to feel the melancholic, like a twin summer of course, as I assume. But no, as I'm hunting, I am contemplating, and the truth is, it's a tad exhilarating, even though it is not inconceivable that I'll be caught. Still, it comes as quite soft to see him understanding you. Poison in his pocket, can discover murdering was easier than he had thought.
Goodbye, eagerly we fly.
All of this is frankly easier than I had thought.
I I returned to town late that night, plagued by the haunting terror that I had left a clue. Sooner or later, someone would come across it. I consoled myself by reading one of Mother's unanswered letters to Lord Aspen C, in which she pleaded with him to take pity on a woman alone with a son of his. So it was a bit of a shock that not long after I should receive a letter from the very same man.
To the Nysquith family and asking us to help you in some situation in which you might earn your living. I must apologize for our unsympathetic attitude on that occasion. Should you still be in need of a post, I will be very pleased if you will pay me a call. Yours very truly,
Nysquith Senior.
Do come in, Mr. Navarro. You are not like the Nysquiths, and yet there is something.
My mother. This is my mother.
We were not well acquainted. It is a very sweet face. Have you ever seen the family portraits at Highhurst?
Family portraits? Never!
Your mother is extraordinarily like some of the women, and some of the men for that matter. I suppose you are wondering why I came to write to you.
Yes, frankly, I am.
I don't know whether you heard that I'd lost my only son recently due to somewhat tragic circumstances. A skating accident.
Yes, my sincerest condolences.
You knew, of course, I was grooming him to succeed me.
I did not.
Well, it is over. The past cannot be recalled. I should like to know if you would come to work into my firm. You could have no greater education in my business of stockbroking. Beyond that, I can make no promises.
Oh, Lord Asquith, I hardly know what to say.
To begin with, you shall have £250 per year.
It's a very generous offer, Your Lordship, considering you'd be going through the trouble of teaching me.
Here is a check for £20. You may want to enhance your wardrobe. I will expect you here at 9 o'clock tomorrow.
Unexpected. Best wishes to you both, naturally.
Oh, I do hope you'll come to the wedding. It is to be the 11th of May.
I shall write it in my diary.
Monty, it's so strange. And everything will change. Think how our lives will be. I don't know what you'll do without me. You're awfully handsome and smart. No, Monty, you'll rise above and you'll put the loss of Sabella behind and you will find someone better to love. Poor Monty, have I just broken your heart? No, Monty, am I to blame? It may look bleak, but in a week, you'll have forgotten my name. I think I can picture her now, young and willing. Oh, it's thrilling! In a way you'll have me to thank. She'll be perfect. A shop girl, a teacher, the sister of a preacher, or a widow with cash in the bank. Poor Monty, cozy in a cottage with two. No, Monty, soon there'll be three. You're a saint to the top. You'll own your own shop, Monty, and I guarantee.
yes, I've been invited into the Dice with Baking House in the city at quite a comfortable salary.
So what he told me was true after all!
You should have never doubted it.
Monty, you've grown older. Not in looks, you still look like a boy, but now you look as if you've never, ever had a care in the world. Don't you want to kiss me?
What about Vine?
What about him?
Sabella, I cannot continue to live as if the very air you breathe is not my last hour narcotic. You don't have to, Sabella. Run away with me.
Monty,
right now.
Don't torture me, please!
Sabella forever. In my heartbreak, I returned to Mother's letters. As you have the good fortune as a diaspora to attend Cambridge, Mother wrote to her young cousin Henry, I know you can appreciate the disadvantages my son Montague will have if he is not permitted to matriculate.
Hello, birds! Hello, sky!
Of course, for Henry Dysworth, a Cambridge education was a mere formality, as he was born into a life of leisure.
Just cause you and your sister earn over half the county does not give you the right to buy my own land from under me. That has been in my wife's family for generations.
I'm afraid you lost your land to the bank, my friend, not to me.
You selfish tool.
I say, why don't we calm ourselves down?
I should call for a concert.
Now look what you've done. Now leave here. Before I have you brought up on charges!
Come along! All right, through with you, Dorsquith! I have you into a rope or I will!
A threat will get you nowhere, sir! I'll foreclose on this whole county if it suits me. It's time these peasants took responsibility for their own lives. Are you quite all right?
Yes. I believe I'll live. Thank you.
I must say, chum, that was awfully cool of you to step in like that.
It's nothing really.
You've come from town, haven't you?
How could you guess?
Oh, one can always tell. It's the way town men put on their clothes, a touch of exaggerated fashion, which betrays a pleasure in personal appearance. People who live in the country don't feel as good born to wear clothes to wear, but that's all rot. What say we have us around, shall we?
Coming up!
That's the least I can offer in return for your gallantry in the aid of a total stranger.
Any man would have done the same.
My name's Dysworth, by the way.
Mine's Navarro.
When the fellow needs a little helping hand, we'll be there, it's almost guaranteed.
No one else could ever really understand. Another man knows what you need. And when a man has fallen down upon his knees, in such a moment, who'd be better than someone with self-control, someone who's strong in bone, someone who's good at go.
It's better with a man.
Better with a man.
Another man, everything just the same. Drink will help
get your troubles off your mind. You're burning blind before you know his name. And in that rousing climax when your horse
comes in, I'm a horse,
will scream as loudly as he can. Only a man can see the meaning of victory over camaraderie. It's better with a man.
Better with a man. Women are much to recommend. Lord knows I've had my share. But when a fella meets a friend, that's a totally different affair.
Women are soft against your skin. They're awfully nice to nestle with.
But when the sport is masculine, you need a man to wrestle with. Gentlemen have secrets they will never. But then thou sayest they will never tell. They'll never tell the wives. Married men know there are things you must not say. Discretion is the only way that love survives.
Men are always
men
there,
always there,
always there to share.
Take a look at
brothers, take a look at us.
Take a look at us.
It's been ever thus since sporting school began.
Women are too complex.
Women do often vex.
Men are the simpler sex.
It's better with a man.
Better with a man.
Better with a man.
Better with a man.
Bottoms up!
I think perhaps you ought to know who I am.
You're not a criminal, I suppose.
No, but I am a cousin of yours.
A cousin?
Yes, my mother was Isabel Dysquick. My father was a Castilian, and worse, a musician.
I say, that doesn't matter. Noblish, oblige, and all that.
All the same, it's that your sister may not care to receive me.
My sister? Oh, she'll be civil. Come on, then. I say, it's quite a relief to have someone to talk to. I've got one or two fellows coming down in a fortnight, but at present it's deadly.
I should think you would move to town.
Oh, I have a place in London, but I'm here Saturday to Monday. My sister keeps the estate going for me. Here's the honey shack. I look forward to you meeting my queen and her drones.
I should be delighted to meet your wife.
Oh, no, my wife lives in London and rarely comes to Salisbury. And we're speaking of my bees. I've developed a bit of a compulsion for beekeeping. I find it endlessly fascinating. And you'd be moving.
I should be afraid of being stung.
Oh, it's nothing to be afraid of, I assure you. Here, watch me. One little sting won't kill you.
Huh. I imagine after time you might build up a resistance.
Quite. I dare say it would take 100 bees to kill me now.
Could one really perish from a surfeit of bee stings?
Happened just last year to a man in Surrey. It was all over the papers. Oh. Come on then.
I had so ingratiated myself to the beekeeper that I was soon invited back as a weekend guest. Just enough time for me to educate myself as to the extraordinary attraction of English lavender to your average honeybee. Upon my return to Salisbury, I paid a discreet visit to the honey shack as soon as I saw the opportunity.
Oh.
Miss Dysworth, I presume.
Oh, you are?
Montague Navarro. Please call me Monty.
Oh, my brother tells me you are a cousin.
Yes, my mother was Isabel Dysworth.
Isabel. Forgive me, but I don't recall ever hearing about her.
Shall I tell you why?
I wish you would.
You see, my father was considered unsuitable, and because my mother married for love and not for wealth or property...
Oh, they cut her off!
...without a shilling. They ever so acted as to mean my mother had never been born.
Why, Mr. Navarro!
I told you, brother, you may not care to receive me.
On the contrary, I am most intrigued. What a beautiful story! Horrid, yes, I'm certain, but still beautiful! She dared to marry... Tell me, did your father have his own fortune, or were you quite penniless? Oh, you must forgive me. Henry often scolds me for being indelicate.
Not at all. My father left no legacy, but we managed to scrape by, my mother and I.
When I think of the indignities you've suffered, it must have inspired an
resentment of the upper classes.
Oh, there we go again! And now I'm making assumptions about you when there's nothing I despise more than people making assumptions about me! I know they talk about me in the village. They say a girl who's rich and from an important family and...
not unattractive?
And they assume... well, they assume a lot of things. But none of them know me at all. Not who I truly am.
Oyster shell itself is unassuming, but look inside, you'll find a pearl. A man who otherwise is unpresuming, we share the same blood as an earl. Do not dismiss a woman of position, she can be tender-hearted, have no doubt. The world would be in awfully good condition if we could all live inside out.
You have a rather refreshing way of putting things, Miss Dysmith.
The belladonna is my favorite flower. I love its shape and its perfume. You would likely join the angels in an hour should you ingest its rather deathy bloom. A man who seems a paragon of virtue could be a scoundrel better versed in sin. There would be many fewer who could hurt you if we could all live outside in. And anyone you'd meet on any London street, if they'd be sweet or horrid, it would show. And I'd be overjoyed, the heartache I'd avoid, if I could look at him and know.
I so often have similar sentiments.
And when I meet the man for whom I'm fated, I'll know the one I've waited for is he. For he will find these wealthy trappings overrated, and he will see what no one sees in me. The girl who reads the classics.
Confess, it occurred to me at the funeral that should I achieve my goal of becoming heir, I could find no finer woman to be my countess than Miss Phoebe Dysmith. Needless to say, I was greatly relieved. As a woman of my own generation, Miss Dysmith did not stand before me in the line of succession. But there were women of my mother's generation who did precede me in the lineage. As a girl, mother had been closest to her cousin Hyacinth. Now an unmarried woman of certain age, her latest charitable venture had secured her a place atop the pecking order of society's elite.
I am proud to stand among the dual-witted of Greater London.
Lady Hyacinth had a virtual monopoly on the feeble-minded, but her valiant efforts disintegrated into scandal when her beneficiaries turned out to be not so dull of wit after all.
A whole year's worth of donations stolen. If I'm ever to show my face in society again, I've got to find a new cause of my own. And quickly, come, any ideas?
Daisy Gravel has the oar.
Lady Sidgwick has the blind.
And the fund for sailors' widows.
That's the two of them combined.
Night school for the nervous.
Lady Beach and Margaret Guest.
Crutches for the crippled.
That was Elsie Bond's request.
Wayward women,
Daisy Rubble,
who's behind disfigured men,
Daisy Rubble,
and the deaf, don't tell me, it's Greville yet again. Everyone's got something, can't you see why I'm bereft? I want to do some good, but what the devil's left?
What the devil's left?
Pardon me, madam.
Yes, speak up. What is it?
Baron Philpot of Foreign Office. We met last month at the Consumptives' Ball.
Oh, yes. You're looking much better.
If I may, one hears of such terrible poverty in Egypt these days.
Egypt? Land of the pharaohs and of Moses the Israelite. Home to the great pyramids and the Sphinx.
Yes, now under great starvation and disease, in need of a new hero. Dare I say, a modern-day Cleopatra.
That's it! We'll populate an orphanage in Cairo with foundlings from the reeds along the Nile to watch a creature grow, to swaddle it and know the joy of its pathetic little smile.
Its little
the
smile.
News will travel soon enough to London.
To London!
Our selflessness will meet with great acclaim.
Huzzah!
The sniping will be stilled, and the empire will be filled with homes for bastard children in my name. All aboard the Luxor Express for Cairo!
And
get the tickets.
What I failed to tell her was that a violent uprising against the Empire was imminent and no British citizen was considered safe. So you can imagine my surprise when Lady Hyacinth returned to London, quite unharmed.
Oh, Baron, I couldn't possibly. The degradation, the deprivation.
What about the children?
Beggars and thieves, the lot of them.
Imagine not rising for God save the king. Oh, where will my largesse be truly appreciated? I need a place so low that hope itself has been abandoned.
You heard, of course, of the untouchables in India.
Oh, India? From Hindus and Muslims of tamarind and saffron, exotic and unknowable. That's it. We'll find ourselves some lepers in the Punjab. The hopeless and the wretched and the cursed. Forgotten and unblessed. I'll take them to my breast.
Your breast.
If Daisy Greville doesn't get there first. When we arrive, they'll hobble out to greet us.
Hello there.
Their toothed skins will melt a heart of stone. Every dilettante will envy me and want a colony of lepers of their own. Now, Nauta, where to even your mothers tell we leave? Although, come to think of it, what is the point of helping others unless you let the whole world know? Call the Times of London!
And off she went. I neglected to mention that the malaria pandemic in the Punjab, a bit of insurance in case leprosy itself failed to prove contagious. So you can imagine my shock when Lady Hyacinth returned to London in a record time, quite the picture of health.
The dear disgusting lepers, they refused to accept our help. It got to the point where they run away to me a sound of my voice.
Willing to penetrate the jungles of deepest, darkest Africa.
Africa! From
Suzulan to Yoruba, home of proud warriors, the naked torsos rippling in the firelight. We'll civilize a village in the jungle.
The jungle!
It can't take long to learn their mother tongue.
The jungle!
Words they have but six, and five of them are clicks. And all of them are different words for dung. Oh, can't you see their frightful painted face?
The faces!
They'll teach us how to swing from vine to thorn.
From vine to vine to vine!
It's Daisy Grevra's loss. She'll never come across a tribe of backward natives worse than mine.
The heart of Tots and Pygmies may appall us,
but even they are part of God's design. We bid you all goodbye.
Goodbye!
Let all of London try to find a tribe of natives worse than mine.
I may have neglected to mention she was headed straight for a particularly noteworthy tribe of cannibals.
Times of London, late edition, society lady disappears in darkest of Africa.
Lady Hyacinth, the royal and tribal incident.
Society lady in African stew?
Lady Hyacinth presumed dead!
Got it!
Lord Asquith, here are the reports you requested, sir.
Excellent work, Montague. Do you know, I was quite astonished to discover how near you are to this succession.
Beg your pardon, sir?
Well, let us consider. If Lord Adalbert, the present Earl, should die, that means there are only two others who precede you. That is, when I, myself, am out of
perish the thought, sir.
Go on as you are doing, Montague, and who knows what may happen. Look at him, no denying his humble start, but it fills up this poor old heart when I see how well he's done. Monty, what is your current salary?
400 per annum, sir.
Let's make it 5, shall we? Look at him. All the loyalty he has shown. How my fondness for him has grown. Till he's almost like a son. Some might have thought him unsuitable. How quickly he's earned my respect. Who would think that the dice with we cast aside could become such a source of pride? He's the last one you'd expect.
It's wonderful. It's wonderful. I'm so happy for you.
Things have changed, haven't they?
And to think
life started in a third-rate terrorist home in Calapa.
It would seem we're both doing rather well, aren't we? We honeymooned in Firenze, and that's Florence, you know.
Ah, is it? Just you and all those marble statues and Lionel? How could you ever tell them apart?
You're horrid! Lionel, I could never expect good looks to bore one so soon.
I'm afraid good-looking people who are stupid try one's nerves harder than plain people who are stupid. At least plain people feel they must make an effort.
Lionel is not only stupid, he is vulgar.
Let's not discuss your honeymoon, shall we?
Let's not.
Who'd have believed? Oh. Who'd have believed that Martina Fado ever would come so far, so fast? Never have seen a man so keen to overcome his past. Now he can live in princely fashion as dice with men requires. He can pursue with all his passion everything he desires. I must go.
Of course you can.
Of course. Some might have thought him unsuitable. They were, of course, incorrect. I always believed in Monty Navarro, even though in retrospect. Who would have guessed this bell I'd ring this very afternoon? Tomorrow?
Tomorrow.
Only just unpacked from my protracted honeymoon. He's the last one you would expect.
Is that everybody is weak? Have you studied eugenics, my friend? We must find a way to prevent the unfit from multiplying themselves. If we fail, I'm afraid we'll lose the empire to through our grasp.
Unthinkable, Major Dysus.
I spent the weekend at Highhurst with my cousin, the Earl. Do you know him?
I know of him, of course.
The gluttony! The endless, extravagant beers!
I'm afraid my constitution would not allow it. I was raised strictly vegetarian.
Why? I myself sit on the council of the London Vegetarian Society!
I had no idea.
What luck! I'm making like this! Have you tried your good culture? Delicious! And a natural laxative, don't you know? Why, I myself had a yogurt enema just the other day! Why not skip the middle man, eh? What? Right! I am now going to lift my own weight, 170 pounds!
Do you think it wise, Major?
Of course not! Thank me, will you?
Yes, of course.
If I cry out before the count often, and I may, you will not hit me! Understood!
Quite. One.
Two
shoes.
What do you mean?
Three.
Okay, it's getting rather heavy.
Heavier than you say. Well, if you say so, Major.
No more.
More? Well, all right, Major Dysus.
Mr. Navarro is here to see you.
Look at me, so completely in disarray, barely able to face the day. Shall I say I'm indisposed?
Show him to the drawing room, Harry.
Look at me, I'm so terribly gray and grim. Rather more than I'd supposed.
Henry had a great admiration for you, Mr. Navarro. He thought of you the gayest man he had ever met.
No one could help but love him.
Henry was not a perfect man, but I was deeply devoted to him. I'm afraid now I'm at somewhat of a loss.
It's a short train ride to London. If you should need me for anything, anything at all.
But if they took a pause to reflect, who but he stood beside me to comfort me? Out of all of the family, he's the last one you'd expect.
Lady Salome Dysus Humphrey returns to the stage.
Lady Salome appearing as Hayden Gabler.
be still available!
Bang! Oh, dear, I didn't hit you, did I?
If justice had prevailed, Lady Salome would have been slaughtered by the critics, thus relieving me of the job.
When I think about it now, there was a kind of courage about it, this hidden intimacy. It was our secret shared by no other living soul. Are you proud?
Remembering the climax of the play, I managed to slip real bullets into Lady Salome's gun. The audience leapt to its feet. Tragically, Lady Salome did not.
Look at him.
Look at him now.
Denying his humble star.
Into a darkest. Indictment of how he's progressed.
When I see how well he's done.
Why submits their obligations is allowed to have our fun.
Look at him.
Look at him. What he showed.
How my fondness for him.
How my fondness has grown till he's almost like a soul. Some might have thought him unsuitable, but if they took a pause to reflect, they would seize on his matchless abilities. He's the best of the rivalries, the last one.
There seems to be a terrible curse on the family. Has it struck you what this means to you?
Sir, the thought has always occurred so unlikely.
There is no doubt business has improved under your care. I should like to double your current salary and announce to the firm that I have appointed you to become my successor.
Your lordship, there are no words.
Only two people left still alive who stand between me, Elda, and me. Only two people left to survive who stand me on the Dicewith family tree. Here's the next one, my employer, Asquith Dicewith. But he treated me so well, how ungrateful to remove him after all. His kindness so would help, but remember, he was hateful. Asquith Dicewith was the cause of mother's grief. He denied her, vilified her, took away her birthright like a thief. On the other hand, has he not been rather decent, making me successor? Got to say, yeah, hate to do it, I've grown rather fond of him and...
Pardon me, Mr. De Baron. It is my sad duty to report that Lord Asquith Dicewith has gone to his great reward.
Oh no, what's happened?
Heart attack, sir. He did not suffer.
Only one person left still alive who stands between the Earldom and me.
Only one who stands between the Earldom and me.
Heirs to the Dicewith fortune who have died since last year, leaving one Montague Dicewith Navarro next to the succession.
How very lucky for Monty Navarro.
How astounding. How peculiar.
It's astounding and peculiar, yes. How utterly peculiar, Monty Navarro. How have you come so very far, Monty Navarro?
I am the next Earl of Highhurst.
bring nothing into this world, and it is certain we carry nothing out. The Lord giveth, and the Lord taketh away. But surely we can all agree that Lord Asquith Dicewith has been taken away from us all too soon. I can recall so many kindnesses in a regrettably short time I knew.
Quite high.
Monty.
Oh, there's that voice with the promise of sin. And oh, those lips are a promise of bliss. And I know that your embrace is a treacherous fate. There's danger in your kiss. This is the face of a woman a man could easily worship for all of his days. But a man could as easily lose his sanity deciphering your game. You are vain and you're heartless, and yet I can sense that there's a shade of sadness that's barely detectable. That I still want you, it's all I may live to regret. You're deceitful, you're delectable. You see the fate of a man who has had the misfortune to spend his life caught in your sway. My Sibella, my Sibella. And I like that way. I like her just that. I want her just that way.
Have you time for a glass of sherry?
Lila will expect me to be home when he arrives.
I wonder, Sibella, what were you to do if I were to marry?
Forbid it!
You think that would be effective?
And if it were not, I should never speak to you again.
Do you mean that?
Well, it would depend on whom you married, and if you married for love
or for self-interest, you mean.
I suppose there is something in marrying for love. I thought I was in love with Lionel, at least a little.
To do you justice, Sibella, I believe you were. Perhaps if we'd married each other, we'd grown bored eventually.
Do you really think so?
There's all the difference in the world in getting to see a woman whenever you want and being obliged to when you don't.
I'm not at all sure I like your attitude! Monty, now that you're all cozy with the dice quits, I wonder if you couldn't get Lionel an invitation to Highhurst?
For Lionel? Or for you?
Oh, it's all for Lionel. It would seem he has political aspirations. Perhaps I'm being a bit presumptuous, asking for a favor for my husband.
Not at all. It's just that I could scarcely get you an invitation to Highhurst when I haven't an introduction to the Earl himself. I would help you if I could.
I know you would. Lionel's not without resources of his own. We'll see who makes it into Highhurst before the other, won't we?
Yes.
Oh, who could that be?
I haven't the slightest idea. Quick, into the bedroom. Don't make a noise. Very still. Miss Dyson.
Mr. Navarro, forgive my intrusion.
Yes, of course.
I needed to see you and see you today. Mr. Navarro. I have arrived at a stunning conclusion. I would lose my resolve if I didn't come here directly to say. I've decided to marry you. I've decided to Henry's gone. Life goes on for me. I have thoroughly thought it through. And the man that I want is you. Even so, there are quite a few that strongly disagree. Nonetheless, I will marry you. I confess that I'm right at you. But unless I am wrong, you long for love as much as I. Is it not? Oh, God, it's a matter of wit! And so, just please.
Absolutely. You've rendered me speechless. May I call you Phoebe?
What am I doing here? This could be dangerous if I'm discovered. Imagine the scandal, and I couldn't handle a scandal so visible. I'll stay invisible, still as can be. But what's going on in that? I can hear voices. I recognize Monty, but is it a woman? And if it's a woman, What is she doing here? Is it the cousin? I wish I could see. And if it's the cousin, it might just be business. It's family business and none of my business. But why is she here in the home of a bachelor? Now, of course, one can point out that I'm here as well, but does she not realize this situation puts her reputation severely in question? The mere suggestion could cause a sensation if I get out here, which is hell.
He wanted to marry
me. I could go home.
I'd be scorned if I married
him. I should go home.
I decided to live my life again. Who believed for my life is
I should be all the grieving. I could
be but he makes me laugh. There is nothing
good. Then the will I have to still be made.
Isn't this fine?
And the gentleness there
in you. Isn't she dying?
You've taken a wounded bird and taught her how to fly.
Oh, this is quite a conventional.
Is it not? Rather than turning the plot. And so will I be your fiancé.
Why don't you send the cow away?
Phoebe, darling,
I recall the day I think I'll cry.
What was that?
What was what?
That sound? Is someone in here?
Pay no attention to that. Just my new manservant. He's just finding his way around. I'll be with you in a moment. Wadsworth! Isn't this madness? You could foresee how one trick of timing could ruin it all. One in the parlor, one in the bedroom, nothing between them but me and a wall. Look at me being noble and pious, my esteem for only bros. But when I am with Phoebe, I'm on fire, thinking of Sabella. Full of desire, passionate, dare I say it, love. But when I'm with Sabella, whom do I inquire? None but Phoebe, perfect and lovely. Who could it love her? Heaven knows. Round and round and round it goes. How happy I'd be to be at your disposal. My darling, of course I accept your proposal.
Now we should kiss.
That would be bliss.
Oh, darling, but first I'll say this. I've decided to marry you.
What do they do?
I've decided to marry you.
What do they do?
Let the tones of cold world above and set me free.
Bestowment. Yes, Wadsworth, I told you I'll be just a moment.
Now, Monty, I think I now should go. But I still want to marry you.
So,
I would not need to marry you.
Just go.
I decided to marry you.
Hello.
I decided to marry you.
A shame I must go.
Who?
Oh, Miss Dicequith, your cousin, our visitor.
Oh, yes, yeah, just some business about selling her brother's horse. Now, where were we? My Sabella, and I like her that
escaped from cannibals.
Society lady arrives home today.
Lady Hyacinth to be greeted by thousands.
Lady Hyacinth falls in gangplank collapse.
Of all the slights and rejection Mother received at the hands of the Dicequiths, Lord Adalbert's were by far the most painful to her. Dear Adalbert, she wrote, why have you not answered my letter, or the one before that? You have been like a brother to me. Surely you cannot turn me away at my hour of my greatest need.
I'm famished. What are you eating?
Everything to drive you to an early grave.
It can't be soon enough as long as you're living.
You'd better hope I die before you. Otherwise I shall feed your remains to the hounds.
I'm counting on you having a prolonged illness. Every inch of you covered in leeches, and I shall savor the act of applying each of them myself. Speaking of leeches, who the devil have you invited to sponge off us this weekend?
Adalbert, you remember Miss Dicequith, of course.
Which one are you?
Phoebe Dicequith, sister of late Henry Dicequith.
Here they are,
Henry!
It's been far too long, my dear. I trust your trip was tolerable.
Half the family's named Henry. Lack of imagination.
Well, quite, ma'am. With Mr. Navarro as my companion, it seemed to take no time at all. Mr. Navarro, I don't think you've yet met the Earl and his Countess, Lady Dicewish.
So you're the young dragon they're all talking about. I suppose your name is Henry, too?
It's Montague.
Hey, that's a fist.
It's an honor to meet you at last.
Lord Navarro, you're here by invitation.
Monty Navarro, you work your way back in.
Charmed.
But please resist the slightest inclination
to feel at home.
Wipe off that grin!
Come, Henry! I will show you some of the weapons that killed our ancestors.
Oh, you may be clever, but Monty, you'll never win.
Thanks, I'd love to.
You'll never win.
Mrs. Lionel Holland.
The pleasure to make your acquaintance, Countess.
Of course it is. My husband so wanted to be here, but he was off on a business trip in Newmarket. I'm hopeless when it comes to horses, aren't you?
Actually, no. I breed.
Well, my husband asked me to express his sincerest regrets. I hope you don't mind I've arrived alone.
How very enterprising of you. Mrs. Holland, I wonder if you've met my husband's cousin, Miss Dicewith. Phoebe, dear, this is Mrs. Holland.
Mrs. Holland, I'm so pleased to know you.
Oh, the pleasure is entirely mine.
Oh, how lovely you look.
Oh, I've been admiring your dress, your flawless complexion, your sparkling eyes.
Oh, you're too kind.
Oh, no, I'm really not.
Mm-hmm.
And I do believe we may know someone in common.
Okay, gather round, won't you? Lady Dicegirth wants me to ask you to raise a glass to my cousin, Miss Dicewith, on the occasion of her engagement to Mr. Henry Dicewith.
Montague.
Mr. Dicewith Montague.
Navarro.
Mr. Navarro Dicewith Montague. A splendid chap, as far as I can tell, and a cousin of mine, strangely enough. His mother was a bit of an embarrassment. Watch it under the bridge, of course, sir. Lady Dicegirth tells me he's next in the succession. Funny that. With everyone else dropping like flies, I shouldn't wonder if his mother made my sleep tonight. Well, I'm getting the evil eye, so do let's get into dinner. If there's anything I can't abide, it's cold. Don't you agree, Nirvana?
Navarro!
Oh, you wrinkled old compot!
Rather a coincidence seeing you here.
Don't Miss Holland me. Just when were you planning to tell me this happy news?
I should think you would want to keep your voice down.
You're always telling me to keep quiet, aren't you?
You would have received an announcement in due course.
An announcement? I will not be treated like her.
Yes.
Oh, you are despicable.
You know, I find it hard to imagine you really have cause to complain me marrying Miss Dicewith.
But you don't have to, Monty. You could call it off. You must.
There was a time we would have fulfilled our natural destiny and married one another.
That would have been a very pleasant arrangement. You would have been so comfortably off, shouldn't we?
Well, I've no doubt you would have scraped along.
Monty, I can't imagine either of us scraping along. We should have hated each other in a week.
It's not true, Sabella. We know each other better than anyone else. We should have loved each other. That is, if you love me the way I love you.
Auntie, I do love you. And if I had not known that you loved me, I should have risked marrying Lionel.
I won't even try to make sense of that convoluted statement.
Auntie, don't!
You specifically requested cod.
She knows very well I detest cod. Who the devil are you?
It's Walter, dear, from
from the kitchen. I gave Bellamy the night off to visit his sick mother.
Sick mother? There's a good one. Most incredible woman I know.
It's true. I never should have believed your vow to love, honor, and cherish.
Till death do us part, my darling.
Oh, it's what I cling to, my sweet.
Oh, the seventh poem in London is dreadful. You simply can't keep someone longer than 6 months. How long have you been here at Ivo, Shingle?
39 years, m'lady. First of next month.
Miss Shingle, what are you doing here?
Enjoy your cod, sir.
Montu, dear, are you quite all right?
Yes, Phoebe, just a bit fatigued, perhaps.
Have you been to the symphony lately? No?
I am sitting here with poison in my pocket. Look whose head is finally on the block. It seems that now at last the moment I've been waiting for is here.
Mr. Holland and I were at the Albert Hall the other evening and...
All that's really left to be decided is the dish to put the poison in, provided I can do what must be done discreetly when the coast is clear.
Aspic, darling?
What? No. Yes, all right. I confess it pains me some to ruin someone's cooking. Oh, for God's sakes, now another servant's looking. I've had a run of luck, but this one does require skill.
An entire program of Beethoven, from the looks of it. He must have been such an unhappy man, don't you think?
Fisher found it must be well selected, so that no one else at all be affected. What an awful waste to do with someone I don't want to kill.
This venison is too rich. Take it away. This cook will kill me yet. So, what do you make of the castle, Novello?
Oh, it's marvelous. Don't you think so, Phoebe?
Oh, yes, marvelous.
It's falling apart and reeks of mildew. Not unlike my husband.
The men who have defended these walls and brought honor to the name of Dicegreath. You see that broadsword over there? Roland, the second Earl, eviscerated his very own brother.
Really, Adelbert?
That crossbow belonged to my grandfather, Charles. The details of the accident remain rather vague.
Well, let's leave it at that, shall we?
Oh, and I must show you the weapon I used to defend the Empire during the Boer War.
Really, Adelbert, must you?
I beg you not to encourage him.
It was the battle of the Hubert Hill back in 81. The Boer stormed the mountain. We were completely surrounded. In the panic, Jürgen, my loyal young Transvaalian valet, suddenly revealed himself as a Boer, cornering me with my own weapon. Martini Henry Mark II, ever fired one.
Adelbert, sit down at once.
Yes, I have looked death in the face, and death looks right back.
Here we go again.
When wood came down the barrel of a gun, it concentrates the mind completely, and suddenly you'll find a love for humankind that makes you look upon the world more sweetly. When all at once it seems your life is done, you recognize it all goes by so fleetly. There's so much left to do, except of course for you, when you're looking down the barrel of a gun.
Oh, this trifle is delicious.
Oh, Lord knows if I eat it, sir. I'll pay for it later. Here.
Oh no, Mr. Holland says if I gain 1 pound.
Nonsense! You have the figure of a teenage boy. This is the best truffle in England. I insist.
I mean, it is a special occasion. I thought it'd be my... Mr. Navarro!
Monty, what are you doing?
Pardon me. So clumsy.
When you're looking down the barrel of a gun,
of a gun,
and the barrel looks right back at you demurely,
demurely,
with an eye that seems to say, perhaps you've got to play. So sorry that you're dying prematurely.
Oh,
you're grateful that you have no little shade of fun.
He's had his fun.
Then you suppose you might have lived your life more purely. It's ludicrous to care. It's neither here nor there. When you're looking down the barrel of a gun. Oh Lord, I could use your intention. Aren't men like me in short supply? Oh Lord, I could use your intervention. This cannot be the way I'm meant to die. Do you really want to see me cry? The boars wore top of us. There was no quarter. Jürgen had betrayed me in spite of everything we've been to each other. Oh, Neville. Take it! Point it at me directly!
Oh, I hope it's loading.
Jürgen, is it something I said? I just wanted to know. I've never held your humble origins against you. No, some of my best friends are boys. Please put down the gun, please. I know I took good game, bravery, courage, and God save the queen and all that. But I really don't want to die. I really, really don't. Don't you know I've loved you like a song?
Congratulations, Your Lordship. I was wondering if I might have a word with you in private.
I'm sorry, do we know one another?
I shouldn't think so. Chief Inspector Pinkney, Scotland Yard. You are the Earl of Highhurst, are you not?
Yes. May I ask what this is about?
So sorry to interrupt such a festive occasion, but I am under strict instructions to arrest you for murder.
Stop. Wait. What? Though I didn't kill Adelbert Dicewith, though that certainly was my intent, but rather hard to digest that I could be arrested for something I did not commit. And it couldn't be poor Cousin Asquith, for he graciously died on his own. Was that hole in the ice just a bit too precise for my presence at Chismere known? Murder, did you say?
I'm afraid so, Your Lordship.
Stop, wait, when? I should doubt I was seen at the harbor. Lady Hyacinth fell in so fast. As for Salome's end, their suspicion would send them at once to the backstabbing cost. Did the beastings reveal my deception? Was I seen at the weightlifting hall? How rude to intrude on this lovely reception, for I am the Earl after all. Yes, I am the Earl after all, though it's come I can see at the cost. But where was my blunder, my weakness, I wonder? Is all of it now to be lost? Is all of it now to be lost? Murdering whom?
Why, Lord Adelbert Dicewith, 8th Earl of Highhurst.
Stop, wait, who? For the murder of Adelbert Dicewith, if there's ever a farce, this is it. I'd rather my death that I could be arrested for again a matter I didn't commit. But surely, the Earl died of a heart attack.
No, Your Lordship, it was foul play.
Of course, I should like to inquire by what method he happened to die, but what to the point would events not conspire to lead them to think it was I? I've dispatched half a dozen, each one a cousin, all of them quite by design. It is not a defense, it just makes no sense.
This meadow's not one of mine.
On the charge of willful murder and the death by poison of Lord Adelbert Dicequith, 8th Earl of Highhurst, how do you plead, my lord?
Not guilty!
Chief Inspector Pinckney, Scotland Yard. No one was allowed in or out of the castle until the guests and all the staff had been interviewed thoroughly.
Dr. Pettigrew, medical examiner. As the postmortem, I examined what Lord Dicequith ingested that night and determined there was poison in the port.
Hilda, sir. It was my job to take the wine from the cellar. I gave it to Miss Chard.
Selina Chard, before dinner began, I poured the port into a decanter to allow the nuttiness to blossom.
Alfred Gorby, no one drank the port but his lordship. I'd swear my life on it.
Poison? In the port? Poppycock. I was in a position to know that the Earl was dyspeptic and quite liberate. That's what killed him. Now, Miss Marietta Shingle.
Lady Eugenia Dicequith, Edmund the Earl, my late husband, said that he feared that Mr. Navarro was so eager to succeed him that he might smother him in his sleep.
Miss Lionel Holland, Monty had every right to rid the Dicequiths. They disinherited his mother. They denied his very existence. Why shouldn't he feel he had his right to take his place among them? Wouldn't you?
Lady Phoebe Dicequith Navarro, Countess of Highhurst. My husband, the present Earl, is the kindest, the gentlest, the noblest of men with the purest intentions, I can assure you.
Your lords, I submit to you that the entirety of this prosecution is nothing but a set of circumstantial evidence with no proof of my guilt whatsoever. I implore you to end this appalling charade at once.
Mind if I tidy up a bit, your lordship? Just a quick once round and I'll be out your way.
By all means, my man, do what you must.
If I might, my lord, the Savior gave quite an impressive speech at the trial today.
Thou art the same, then?
Oh, yes. I was quite proud to hear that I was. Being a Dicewith myself, you know.
I'm sorry. Did you say you were a Dicewith?
Oh, yes. Chauncey Dicewith. My father was Nesmith Dicewith. Maybe you've heard of him? Bit of a black sheep he was. Family never wanted nothing to do with him. Can't say I blame them. Wasn't much of a father, neither.
You're a Dicequith. You're a Dicequith. And you've been here for 6 weeks, and I had no idea.
Bit of shy sort, really. But tonight, didn't know as I'd be seeing you again. Whatever happens, I wish you the best of luck, my lord.
Yes, thank you.
Lady Navarro, Countess of Highhurst is here to see you, my lord.
How are you, my darling?
Fine that you've now come to see me.
Monty?
I beg you not to worry about the outcome of tomorrow. I've come to believe that an unknown providence is watching over me.
I do believe that, I do.
But your face, it torments me so.
I do have one thing to ask.
Anything, Phoebe, darling, really.
That woman, Mrs. Holland.
What about her?
That awful night at Highhurst, and then again at the trial. The way that she looked at you.
Looked at me, I mean...
I am asking but one thing of you, Monty, and I must have the truth. Is she in love with you?
Love? I mean, strong...
Now you have to speak! You've just given me your answer!
And so I have no more of this memoir to write. The ending will be revealed in the morning, one way or the other, with the verdict of the jury. For now, I must try to sleep, though I should think it will be unlikely.
That horrible woman, that contemptible girl.
Countess Navarro.
Oh, make no mistake, she's a venomous snake, and she poisoned the Earl. That Mr. Navarro was a part of her plan. I have come here to save him. He's an innocent man.
Do you know what you're saying, Miss Holland?
That horrible woman. Do not
as she poisoned the pot and diverted the blame. Go and bring her to justice, just as fast as you can. As I've told you, my husband is an innocent man. She seemed transcendent
from waters to desert.
Yes, she flirted and batted her eyes at the men.
She rose from her seat
and she reached for a sweet.
Every gesture was mad.
They
no one saw her but me.
In a blink she put drops in his drink.
That's quite
what she told.
You will believe he's just come to see me and quiet in the nick of time.
I was about to tell you the same thing.
It seems Miss Horrow did it.
Miss Horrow?
I've got evidence. It's quite convincing.
Well, they can't both have done it.
Dear Monty.
Monty, darling.
It was I who poisoned the Earl.
It was time you took your rightful place.
This is astonishing.
She says she intercepted the letter
before it was handed to Miss Navarro.
Well, we can't arrest one woman and believe another one's guilty.
The law won't allow it.
No jury would convict. Reasonable doubt. Seems we're in a bit of a bind.
It was done out of greed.
It was done out of spite.
She wanted the title.
She wanted revenge.
And my husband, she knew, would be head for the crime.
She,
as I say,
she's a merciless.
Monstrous assassin,
no be. She must be released.
That sinister wench.
Pray you do what is just.
Stop the jury, you must
get us safe from the bench. In the name of King Edward, we must do what we can.
As the ending was changed when the nightingale said,
rearranged, we must not let him pay. For Montague dies with no Navarro. He's an innocent man. He's an innocent man. He's an innocent
Yes, what is it?
Your lordship, the indictment's been dropped. You're being set free.
I don't understand.
The jury's been excused, and you are to be released at once.
I hardly know what to say.
Come with us, your lordship, come with us.
You can hear them cheer for you, can't you, my lord?
Surely that can't be for me. I...
Well, I don't mind saying, your lord. I knew you had to be innocent. You're bloody over heaven's sake.
Yes, yes, thank you.
Look at Phoebe, noble and pious, my esteem for only grows. But when I am with Phoebe, why?
Monty!
Cybella, full of desire, passion, and dare I say it, love. But when I'm with Cybella, who I admire.
Monty!
Perfect and lovely, who couldn't love for heaven knows. Round and round and round and round and round.
What a fantastic story, your lordship. You're sure to have something for your memoirs now.
My memoirs!
Oh, not the memoirs.
The memoirs.
Oops, yes.
My memoirs.
And a flash might need it.
How very thoughtful. Thank you.
Monty Navarro, how have you come so very far? Monty Navarro, too far to comprehend. Monty Navarro, no one knows who you really are. What will your future portend? Monty Navarro.
The next Earl of Highest.
And this is not.
The thought occurs, if I didn't poison the Earl, who did?
Prussic acid, in just the right amount, works almost instantly. Oh, of course, if Monty had ever been found guilty, I had every intention of coming forward to confess my crime. Long live the Earl!
I'm still the next Earl of Highhurst!
And this is not the...
I'm standing here with poison in me pocket!
This is not the
track.